Okay, a few comments. First, when I talk of the flame velocity, you should be careful that the flame velocity is different when you ignite a flame from the closed end of a tube or when you ignite a flame from an open end of the tube. You will see that. You have a difference of velocity which is in the ratio of the temperature. So it's important, okay? See, this is just, I want to to give you this this comment too, because you may have, you will see that, because in my lecture escape. This one is okay. And now we are moving on to the second lecture. Okay, which this lecture is a little bit, I am sorry, it becomes a little bit, where is my tick? Okay, it's a little bit more technical. Yeah, I am going to discuss the governing equation. I will not go into the more detail. Can you read it? What is written is, yes. Yeah. You know, you have, if you are interested, if you do, excuse me, maybe for the man, I have to go down. If you are doing numerics, for example, as many of the young people enjoy to do the numerics, you know. And if you are doing numerics, you need to use, Professor Poinsot will discuss that, I guess. You need to use a complete set of equations. For me, it's not necessary. I just want to pick the essential mechanism to explain to you the phenomena. But if you like to have the complete set, you have an excellent book, De Groot et Mazur, which is not recent, but it's fairly complete. So keep that in mind. And you have the book of Farman Williams also, which is very complete, which is very detailed. Okay, I will give you, maybe you are less familiar with the last item, which is entropy production. It's not very useful for combustion, except to understand a few things about the shock waves that I am going to explain to you. Okay, now let me start to define what is an extensive quantity. Extensive. This is quantity which increase like the quantity of matter you are considering. So all the time it is related to a volume of matter that you are considering, and it is the space integral on this volume of the mass density here of the mixture time a mass weighted distribution of quantity A. This is sometimes we call this low cap A, we call that density of quantity capital A. Right? This is the definition of an extensive quantity. Give me an example of a quantity which is not extensive.
Temperature.
Temperature, pressure, not extensive, okay? But energy and so on, mass are extensive quantity. Hello, professor. Good to see you. Okay, so there are two ways to change, to change this quantity capital A. A first way is through fluxes across the boundary of the volume. And this takes the form, you know, this is the first way to modify the time, to make the time, the temperature, the time, the derivative with respect to time of the quantity A, there is a V which is missing here, and I assume that V is constant here, okay? I consider a constant volume. And the first manner to change this quantity here, A, is a transfer across a boundary here. And this takes the form of, should take the form of an integral volume of a surface integral on the around the surface delimiting the volume and the boundary. And this, using the divergence theorem, this can be put on the in the form of a volumetric integral, the volume of the vector field, which is the flux of the quantity A, which is a vector here. If the quantity A is a scalar, this this field is a vector field, which is called the flux. This is the first way. You know, it's very simple. In this room, you have a number of people. Assume that A is a number of people. You have doors, people coming in, people coming out, and you make varying the number of people. This is exactly that. There is a second way, which cannot be put in the form of an integral, a surface integral. For the people here, it is difficult because there is no babies that are just born, you know. So, but so this, for example, is a case of chemical reactions when you consider a species, for example, a reactant or a product. It is product in the volume by the chemical reaction. And this term here cannot be put in the form of the integral of a surface. In other words, this term here, which is a reaction rate, volumetric reaction rate, cannot be put in the form of a divergence of a flux. Not possible. This is a two-way. So now, because this is true, whatever be the volume V, it is true, you have this local equation here, which says that this term here equals this term here plus this term here. This is now, what do we call a conserved quantity? A conserved quantity is a quantity that has no production term, that all the variation is coming from the exchange at the boundary. This is what I am going to call a conserved quantity. It is not fixed, it is conserved. If for a scalar, conserved scalar, the flux here is a vector field. If the conserved scalar is a vector, the flux is a tensor. Okay, this you, because of you have this contraction operation here, you decrease of one from one the order of the a tensor, divergence of a tensor become a vector, divergence of a vector become a scalar, right? Okay, these are elementary things. Now let's start with the first quantity, which is conserved. At least in classical mechanics, this is no more right in relativity because mass and energy, mass, you may change mass in energy, but in classical mechanics, mass is a conserved quantity. There is no possibility to create or to consume a mass, and the only way to change the mass inside a volume, fixed volume, is to have a flux coming out and or coming in, a balance of the flux. And this flux, in fact, it is in fact the definition of the flow velocity. This is the flow is a density, mass density times the flow velocity. In fact, you may consider that as a definition of the flow velocity. You will see that, in fact, this flow velocity is in fact the velocity of the center of mass of the small particle of fluid that you are considering. Okay, so the conservation equation for this for the mass takes simply, because it is a conserved scalar, takes simply this form. the form of a, what is called a continuity equation. You know that very well. It is useful to introduce the derivative, the material derivative, which is the time variation, the rate of variation when you follow the fluid particle in its motion. So you have the partial derivative with respect to time plus a term coming from the motion of the fluid particle. Do not confuse a fluid particle with a microscopic particle, atoms and molecules that are constituting the fluid. Okay, I use fluid particle and microscopic particle to differentiate the two. It is a simple exercise to show that from this equation, you may use this equation. For using this definition of the continuity equation takes this form. This form is very useful. It tells you that the rate of change of the density is exactly the divergence of the flow velocity. And in fact, this is, in mathematical term, it can be used as a definition of the divergence of a vector, in fact, when we think of, about that. Sometimes it is more useful to introduce the specific volume, which is the volume per unit mass, which is just the inverse of the mass density. And here you have only the same relation, except the sign is changed because you have the inverse. Okay? And this is very clear also. The divergence of the flow velocity is an expansion or a compression rate. You know, expansion or compression rate. You change the volume, is the rate of change of the volume per unit time. Okay. Now, it is useful sometimes to use a Lagrangian form of conservation equation. This is what is called a Eulerian form that I have just presented to you in the first slide. And it is useful to introduce, you know, to introduce a different flux here by subtracting the convective fluxes here, you know, from the total flux. Usually we call that the diffusion flux. One has to be careful with the energy with this definition. We will see. Okay. It's a simple manipulation to show that this equation, using this definition now, takes this what I call in French, we call that in French Lagrangian form, because Lagrange was French, you know, so we are very proud of Lagrange, and we call that a Lagrangian. I don't think you call that Lagrangian form. You call that maybe you call that material derivative, or I don't know. So this form is the same as this one because the convective flux is absorbed in the material derivative. That's very simple, okay? It's just a game. And now a conserved scalar, now, because by definition a conserved scalar has no production term or conception term, a conserved scalar, the balance, the local balance of a conserved scalar in Lagrangian form takes this simple form where you have only here the flux, which is the difference of the total flux minus the convective flux, which is usually called the diffusion flux, but should be pay attention to the energy. You will see it's a little bit more subtle than that. Right. Okay, now let me go to the, move on to the fixed law and to the diffusion equation. When you have a mixture with different species, it is useful to introduce, especially in combustion, to use the mass fraction of the species instead to use the ratio, the concentration, for example, which is the ratio of the density of the number of particles, it's better to use in combustion the mass fraction, okay, which is the ratio of the mass of the quantity y divided by the total mass, and if you divide both of them by the volume, you have the ratio of this density. This is called the mass fraction, and by definition, if you sum the mass fraction on all the of all the species, you should find one by definition. Now, let me consider an inert mixture. That means that there is no production term in the for the species for any species. So you the equation should take this form, and because the sum of y I is 1, the sum of the of this flux, g prime 1, which are here diffusion flux, should be 0 when you sum over all the species. Now, I will not give you detailed kinetic theory of gas, but I think that you will have some course here of kinetic theory of gas. So, what we may consider that, you may consider that for the moment, as the simplest relation linking the diffusion flux with the mass flux. You notice that the diffusion flux of the species E, species high, is here related only to the mass the gradient of the mass fraction I. The real world is much more complicated than that. This relation is only true or accurate, let's say, true does not mean anything, is only accurate for a very dilute system. When you have one species which is much abundant than all the other, this relation is okay. So this is the case in air. You have nitrogen in air, which is more abundant than, so it's a good relation. Otherwise, you will have a very complicated relation, yes. I do not need a complicated relation. I will explain everything with this simple relation here. Now, if you introduce this, what is called the Fick law here, in this equation here, you obtain what is, assuming that rho dE, the rho times the coefficient diffusion is constant, assuming that to simplify the analysis here, you take this quantity outside from the space derivative, and you have the Laplace here of the mass fraction, and you simplify by rho, and you have this equation which is called a diffusion equation. This equation is the archetype of the irreversible phenomena. It is the key of the dissipation mechanism. It explains everything, the entropy growth and so on. So I will just, and I have recall here that this equation can be obtained looking to studying the random work that I have mentioned in my first lecture, which was very well developed by Einstein at the same time as he developed the special relativity. He was the one who developed clearly the link between random work and diffusion. Now, as I told you, people understood before that Maxwell understood that also. But the one who developed the correct formalism for that was Einstein. So to understand the diffusive damping, one has to be back to Fourier. And you, because this equation is linear, it is a linear equation in y. So if you multiply y by something, you multiply on both sides. So it's a linear equation. Because of that, if you use a Fourier decomposition in space here, you see, you replace the distribution of mass fraction function of the space and time in terms of a sum of products of space, and the space are harmonic function, cosine and sine, okay? K is a wave number here. And now the coefficient is a time-dependent coefficient. You have separate the time variation from the space variation in each term here. This is a key point of the Fourier analysis. But because the differential equation is linear, this equation works also for each term. So if you put that, if you put each term in this equation, you obtain an evolution equation for tilde y, which is the amplitude of this, which is simply you have a relaxation, you find out, you know, this is a simple ordinary differential equation of first order, whose solution is an exponential in time, where not here, zero here denotes the initial condition. So you solve this equation completely and you obtain the solution for each component of the Fourier analysis, and you find out that each component decreases to zero. This means that it is a quite irreversible process. Whatever be the initial condition, if you are in an infinite medium, you go to zero at the end. So this is quite irreversible, all right? Okay, this is why it is so important. Now, just few words, but I don't want to go into the detail, to the Green function. Green function is a solution of the diffusion equation that has, as an initial condition, a Dirac function. And this corresponds exactly to the random work of a test particle starting at t equals zero at the origin, and then random. All right? And it turns out, you may do that as an exercise. Take this expression here, put it in the equation, diffusion equation, and you will find that it works. But what is very important in this equation is that if the time t is going to zero, okay, you, because this exponential term r squared divided by 4 dt go to infinity, and exponential minus infinity go to zero, so you go to zero at t equals zero, except if r equals zero. And now it is also an exercise to verify that this Green's function here, this solution, is normalized to unity. So you have a function which is at t equals zero, zero everywhere, so except at the origin, and the integral is one. This is a delta function. So you see, it's not necessary to go to very complicated mathematics. Behind this, there are complicated mathematics. But you may understand that like that. And it is very important because this equation here, this Green function, which is solution of this equation with the delta function, is enable you to compute the evolution of any initial distribution. You too. Assume that this is the initial distribution here at time equals zero of the density, the number density of the particle that you are looking at. Here we were looking to one particle, this test particle. Now you considered n particles, all of them starting at the origin. And now you have a spot that was the half width increase with time, like square root of dt. This is exactly in your milk. If you put a small drop, very carefully, your coffee, put that in the small, and you wait and you look what happened, how this spot is growing in time and decrease in intensity, in color. It was black to begin with, and it will finish gray or white if it is very small. And if you look to the size of this, if you look to the time of the evolution of this, of the radius, or mean radius, or let's say, you find that it increases like a square root of dt. And this, you know, it's easy to find out that this g here, which is this term, which is a convolution in space with the initial distribution, whatever it is, times this Green function, give you the solution of this equation here for this initial condition. So it is a very powerful tool, this Green function. And behind that, there are a lot of physics, in fact. Now, let me go to the conservation of, conservation of momentum. When you have an isolated system, mechanics tell you that if you have particles, an ensemble of particles that are isolated, which are interaction with the outside world, you should conserve the momentum. So if you should conserve the momentum, this the equation of evolution should be written in that form here, where this capital pi here is what we call a stress tensor, which is a tensor, you know that, it's to refresh your mind. Okay? And this tensor you decompose in two parts. One is the isotropic part, which is the hydrostatic pressure, in fact, P. Y is the unit tensor, and the viscous effect in gas, because we are in fluid. In solid, it will be different. This pi will, this small, low cap pi will have a different expression. So this is the thermodynamic pressure, it is a, and now for viscous stress in a fluid, you have this relation relating the stress, the viscous stress to the flow field. I just mentioned that for you, but it is not, I will not use so many times this. So I do not spend time on that. And the gravity now, you may also use gravity. It turns out that the body force gravity can be put also as a divergence of a vector. So here are the equations you obtain when you put this viscous stress in it. This is called the Navier-Stokes equation. You have two terms. You have, okay, this are not dissipative terms. The dissipative terms are here, and you notice the term of dissipation. Why? Look, if you look to this term balanced by this term, it is a diffusion equation. So this term here is a dissipation mechanism that is going to put dissipation in your system, that dumps any. This is not the case for the pressure of the gravity. This is in French, we say non-reactive forces. Reactive force, excuse me. Okay, one defined the shear diffusivity as the viscosity divided by the density, because you have the density. And you see now, if you take out the, when you balance the left-hand side with Laplacian of U times the eta here, you have a, you introduce a diffusion coefficient, which is the viscous shear diffusivity. And when the system is non-dissipative, when you have no external force, you end up with what is called the Euler equation. This is not dissipative at all. There is no dissipation in the system. There is no, and you will understand better what means dissipation when I am going to do the balance of energy, of internal energy, and so on. But right now you understand that this equation is quite different.
How do you distinguish the diffusion and the dissipative?
I call dissipative. Every diffusion mechanism is a dissipative mechanism. But you have different diffusion mechanisms. Diffusion of species, molecular diffusion. You have diffusion of momentum, viscosity. Okay, this is also a dissipation mechanism. You know, all the mechanisms that are going to damp the system, or in other words, as you will see at the end of this lecture, to increase the entropy, this is called a dissipative system. This dissipation mechanism as a mechanism that brings the system to equilibrium, fully equilibrium, if it is isolated. You let the system go, and it will go to a uniform state, equilibrium state. And this is the dissipative term. And the dissipative term are all same kind of diffusion term. Diffusion of spaces, diffusion of momentum, diffusion of energy, thermal flux. Okay? This is so. Okay? Is that clear? Yeah. This is a question of vocabulary. Okay. Okay. And this is this Euler equation, which was written by the same Euler than I have discussed before, that was the first scientist who understands that combustion is proceeding through propagation of waves. This is the first. For those who are interested, I may tell you the story of Euler. It's a very strange story. Now we go to the total energy. Okay, the total energy should be conserved. There is no problem about that. This is also a result of the physics. All the energy is a conserved quantity. Okay, but this total energy is constituted by, first, an internal energy, which is itself in two parts. One is what is called the thermal energy, and the other will be called the chemical energy, which comes from the chemical bonds that are so useful in combustion, okay? Because if there were no combustion, no chemical bonds, there is no combustion. And the thermal energy is very easy to understand for monoatomic gases, because this is simply the kinetic energy of the microscopic particle relative to the center of mass of the fluid particle. You understand? So you have a fluid particle is an ensemble of microscopic particles. This ensemble has a center of mass. This center of mass moves with the velocity, hydrodynamic velocity, u. And now the motion of each microscopic particle relative to the center of mass, this motion defines a kinetic energy, which is a thermal energy. This is true for monoatomic gas. Now, when you are dealing with complex molecule, this thermal energy includes also rotational and vibrational energy. Okay, this just change the specific heat, so it's not very useful to what I am to say. It is very useful for many purposes in combustion, but not for what I have to say. The internal energy, the definition of the internal energy, it is in a gas, it is an additive quantity, which means that you may identify the quantity of the part of this energy which is supported by each microscopic particle. It is the sum of the energy of each particle. Okay, this is not also a comment very useful for the following. Now, the total energy is the internal energy, the sum of the thermal energy, ET, times the chemical energy here, plus the energy of the center of mass. Okay? This is the total energy. And this one should be a conserved scalar. This one should be a conserved scalar. Not the other. The other are not conserved. You are changing energy between all the different forms of energy. This is why you have combustion, in fact. So, because it is a conserved scalar, the total energy should take this form. And now I have defined here the flux of the total energy prime, which is the total flux minus the convective flux in order to write the balance, the local balance in the Lagrangian form here. Okay? This is just change of notation. Now, let me go to make you very clear about this conservation energy to start with an inviscid flow without chemical reaction. Simple thing. Now, you take the Euler equation that I okay. Rho d over dt u, this mean vector, minus grad p. You multiply that by scalar, by u, okay? And you obtain on the left-hand side 1/2 rho d over dt u square, and on the right-hand side, you obtain u scalar grad p minus sine, all right? This is straightforward. Now what you can do is to take out the space derivative in front, put it in front of pu and subtract what you have had, which is p divergence of u. And now if you put that now in this equation here, you add this term here, p minus p divergence u, in the right-hand side of this equation here. Okay? Because you have this. And now this term here, p divergence of u, is in fact the work done. This is nothing else than the first law of thermodynamics tells you that forget about the chemical reaction, because I say that there is no chemical reaction, so forget about the energy, chemical energy. So it tells you that the variation of the internal energy is due to the heat flux plus the work done. Why it is the work done? Because p divergence u is, remember, is the rate of variation of the volume, PdV, what you first law of thermodynamics. So this shows you that the pressure effect this pressure effect in the Euler equation give you in the energy equation the term which is known as the work done in the system. Once again, I will use in all my lecture the simple Fourier law relating the heat flux to the temperature gradient through the thermal conductivity. So now, if you use you may use now the thermodynamic relation linking the variation of the internal energy to the temperature through the specific heat, and you use the thermal diffusivity, you obtain the diffusion equation of Fourier for the temperature, which is known as the Fourier equation, which is a diffusion equation, which shows you that it is relaxing. Damping all the process. Okay? That was in the case where I have no flow, so this term disappears, and the chemical energy is constant, so I have this equation. This is important to realize that diffusion flux are dissipative phenomena that damps any evolution. Okay, now. If I go to a reactive mixture now in the chemical energy here, you saw this. I have two terms. I have a term which is coming from the chemical reaction, and the term coming from the diffusion flux of each species, you know, because the chemical energy can be put in the form of a sum of all each species, where Hi here is the formation enthalpy of formation for those who have some habit of combustion words. And so this is this form. And the form of the conservation of Lagrangian form with a particular, there is a misprint here. You know, you have to put this parenthesis on the left of this bar, here, okay? the Lagrangian derivative time of the total energy multiplied by rho is equal to a diffusive flux, but this now diffusive flux contains two terms. It is not very useful for the following, but for example, in your note, this is not written. It's I skip this. But for those who have a detail, who need a detailed analysis, I have rewritten here the thing. So now, the internal energy you use this thermodynamic relation, and I will use for simplicity the fact that the specific heat is constant. This is easily removed also. It's not very important. It could be important from a quantitative point of view, but it is not important for understanding, basic understanding of the phenomenon. So now you end up with this equation, which is a thermal equation. And you have in this thermal equation on the left-hand side, you have the particulate derivative of the temperature. On the right-hand side, you have the heat flux using the Fourier law. And you have the work done here. And now, in addition, you have this reaction rate here, because, you know, which is written here, where WG is the rate of the Gth reaction, which is exactly the number of time per unit time and unit volume that the reaction proceeds. All right? This is overall. But I will give you details of that when I need it. So now, if you use a continuity equation and you wrote that P divergence U is minus the rate of the rate of variation, time rate of variation of mass density, and you now take out this time derivative in front of you, you obtain d over dtp, and then you have to subtract d over dt p over rho times rho. This is p, but because p, this is p here, and I use an ideal gas law, I have Cp minus Cvt here. So this you have a minus sign here, okay? But this minus sign with this minus sign here give you a plus sign, and this plus sign is going to balance with this, and you are left with Cp. This is what is written here. Now, when I have written in a different way my thermal equation. On the left-hand side, I have the Lagrangian derivative of the temperature. On the right-hand side, now, I have changed. Instead of having the work done, I have the Lagrangian, the particulate derivative of the pressure. But the price to pay to have this is to change your CVE into Cp. That's all. You see? It's not very complicated. Okay, so this is the equation that I am going to use in my lecture. You have the conduction, the compression due to dp over dt, and the chemistry here. And clearly, you understand that the chemistry term has transferred the energy, chemical energy, into a thermal energy. You see, this is the source term. So this thermal energy is not a conserved scalar. The total energy is a conserved scalar, not this energy. All right. Now, yes, I have to stop. Here I have written, once again, in the simplest form that I will use, the governing equation for an inviscid flow, I will take the viscosity because you will see why, of a reactive gas. You have, okay, continuity, Euler, ideal gas law, thermal equation, species evolution. All right? This is, every term in this equation are clear. Very simple. No, not very simple. Clear. It's different. You may write this equation, or it will be useful for detonation, in the detonation study, to work that, to write that in the conservative form. It is also useful, I think, for in numerics. I think that you use a conservative form more easily than that. So in the conservative form, because I am sure that Professor Poinsot will develop that. In the conservative form, you write, it is interesting to write the evolution. Now it is the Lagrangian evolution, the partial derivative of the total energy per unit volume, because you have multiplied by the density here, in the form of divergence of something. And this divergence of something is this quantity here that it is easily to understand. You have, this UP that is coming from this give you when you put U in factor and rho, you have P over rho U, and this is a convective flux. Alors, you see, this is what I like to mention to begin at the beginning of this lecture, that you see, the diffusive flux is here. But now, in the total energy, the convective, you do not have only the convective flux of the total energy. You have the convective flux of the enthalpy. This is the difference. When you take out the convective flux from the total flux, you do not have the diffusive flux only, but you have, in addition, the P over rho, gradient of P, of P over rho, divergence of rho U or P over rho, okay? So if I use a progress, this is a progress variable, is just a definition, and the total energy that you have here, the total enthalpy, and in fact, maybe there is something missing here, no, I don't, maybe there is, I don't know. The total enthalpy, it's right. The total enthalpy here is CPT plus U squared over 2 divided by this progress variable. If you have difficulty with this, don't worry too much about that. I will go into the detail later. For a viscous flow, I have written here the one-dimensional compressible flow in the form I have written here, in the form of one-dimensional in conservative form. But here also, it's not useful for the moment. Okay, a break of 10 minutes, and we'll start in 10 minutes, okay? I think it is time to have a break now, okay?